there is nothing wrong with your television set. Do not attempt to adjust the picture. We are controlling transmission. If we wish to make it louder, we will bring up the volume. If we wish to make it softer, we will tune it to a whisper. We will control the horizontal. We will control the vertical. We can roll the image, make it flutter. We can change the focus to a soft blur or sharpen it to crystal clarity. For the next hour, sit quietly and we will control all that you see and hear. We repeat, there is nothing wrong with your television set. You are about to participate in a great adventure. You are about to experience the awe and mystery which reaches from the inner mind to the outer limits.
Everybody, welcome to episode number 3 of the Night Watch. I'm your host, Mr. X, and with me tonight is a special guest, Jeff. Jeff Wefferson is an American living in Australia. He's an artist, an activist, and blogger as well. Hello, Jeff.
How are you today?
Very good, sir. How about yourself?
Excellent.
Good to hear.
I was feeling a little eclipsed earlier.
Yeah, literally a bit. Our my usual co-host Christina, aka Rad Chick, is not with us tonight, unfortunately. She found out about the passing of somebody very close to her, and is feeling a little bit under the weather. So our thoughts and prayers go out to her. How's everything over on that side of the earth, my friend?
It's upside down compared to where you are, or actually, you're upside down compared to us. I'm actually looking at a postcard here that shows a map of the world, but it's upside down. It shows Australia on the top of the world. And I mean, why not? Why do we have directional chauvinism in terms of our orientation in the heliocosm?
Isn't that true?
But it was really funny. I'll never forget the very first time when I first came to New Zealand in the year 2000, the very first night that I ever saw the stars from the southern hemisphere. Oh, my God. It'll always be etched in my mind, in my mind's eye, so permanently. The stars from down here, you can see a whole region of the sky that's not visible from up there, and it's the most brilliant right. part of the Milky Way.
And, I couldn't imagine. I haven't had an opportunity to see the Milky Way as often as I have, and as a matter of fact, the clearest I've seen it is when we were visiting our friend Jules, who's always behind the scenes during the show, but we are visiting her in New York and really got a beautiful up-close view of the Milky Way, bigger than I had ever seen it. So I could only imagine how crystal clear and beautiful it is where you're at.
How up-close were you?
We were in the, foothills, not the Adirondacks. The Adirondack.
Yes.
Elevation was about 2,000 feet.
I see. Yes, I was just actually making a joke on, like, if you actually got closer to the Milky Way than here.
Well, I wanted to start out real quick with a couple of news briefs, but before I do that, I would like to read the first couple paragraphs of the Declaration of Independence. In Congress, July 4th, 1776, and you'll understand why I'm doing this once I get into the news real quick. In Congress, July 4th, 1776, the unanimous declaration of the 13 United States of America. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed. That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate the governments long established should not be changed for the light and transient causes. And accordingly, all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations, pursuing invariably the same objects, is a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw out such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. The history of present King of Great Britain is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having in direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let facts be submitted to candid world. And then it goes on to state the facts. Folks, my reasoning for reading that original portion of the Declaration of Independence is jumping right into some news briefs here. The first one is out of the Huffington Post. Residents in more than 30 states have filed for secession petitions. Residents in more than 30 states have filed secession petitions with the We the People program on the White House website. Petitions to strip citizenship of individuals signing on petitions to succeed and exile them have also been submitted. A threshold of 25,000 signatures must be met within 30 days for petitions to be reviewed. The Obama administration explains, quote, if a petition meets the signature threshold, it will be reviewed by the administration and we will issue a response, end quote. Micah H., no last name provided, of Arlington, Texas, filed a petition that had nearly 60,000 signatures as of Tuesday morning. It reads as follows. The U.S. continues to suffer economic difficulties stemming from the federal government's neglect to reform domestic and foreign spending. The citizens of the U.S. suffer from blatant abuses of their rights such as the NDAA, TSA, etc. Given that the state of Texas maintains a balanced budget and is the 15th largest economy in the world, it is practically feasible for Texas to withdraw from the Union, and to do so would protect its citizens' standard of living and re-secure their rights and liberties in accordance with the original ideas and beliefs of our founding fathers, which are no longer being reflected by the federal government. Unfortunately for Mr. Micah H. and Peter Morrison, a Texas GOP official who called for an amicable divorce from the United States last week, secession is not in the cards for the Lone Star State. Texas Governor Perry, Republican, sought to distance himself from the petition on Monday. The Dallas Morning News reported that the Republicans' governor's press secretary wrote in an email, quote, Governor Perry believes in the greatness of our union and nothing should be done to change it, but he also shares the frustrations many Americans have with our federal government, end quote. The following is a list of states that have also had residents file for secession. Alabama, Alaska, Arizona, Arkansas, California, Colorado, Delaware, Florida, Georgia, Idaho, Illinois, Indiana, Kansas, Kentucky, Louisiana, Michigan, my home state, Minnesota, Mississippi, Missouri, Montana, Nebraska, New Hampshire, New Jersey, New Mexico, New York, Nevada, North Carolina, North Dakota, Ohio, Oklahoma, Oregon, Pennsylvania, Rhode Island, South Carolina, South Dakota, Tennessee, Texas, Utah, Virginia, West Virginia, Wisconsin, and Wyoming. So I found that to be pretty interesting. And at this point, I think the last count that we had seen was there are over 350,000 signatures. Each petition for each state needs a total of 25,000 signatures to be reviewed by the White House. And as the original article said as well, there is also a petition that was put out by a gentleman asking to strip the citizenship from everyone who had signed the petition to succeed and exile those people from the United States. So this is really gaining a lot of momentum going both ways, and it'll be really interesting to see which way or what happens with this and what the White House has to say about it once they have to or are forced to review all these petitions. And next bit of news I want to jump into was concerning our lovely General Petraeus and his resigning due to the sex scandal. I'm sure you guys heard about that over there, Jeff.
I read a little about it. I don't really pay too much attention to the feminine news like that.
I try not to, but being it goes right along with the news with the state seceding, I believe it personally. It has a lot to do with, and he was scheduled to testify in front of Congress for the Benghazi incident, and now all of a sudden he's just needing to step down from his position due to a sex scandal. And this article I'm reading right now is out of Bloomberg today. General faces inquiry on emails to Petraeus' friend. So basically the story broadens here. The U.S. Marine General in charge of Allied forces in Afghanistan is under investigation after the FBI found emails showing inappropriate communication with a woman whose harassment complaint triggered the resignation of the CIA Director David H. Petraeus, a U.S. defense official said. General John Allen, who was nominated last month to become NATO's Supreme Allied Commander, is being investigated by the Pentagon's Inspector General after the Federal Bureau of Investigation found emails between him and Jill Kelly, according to the official, who was on a military plane and spoke to reporters on condition of anonymity. The FBI has handed over 20 to 30,000 pages of documents, most of them emails, the official said. President Barack Obama has put on hold Allen's nomination to head U.S. forces in Europe at the request of Defense Secretary Leon Panetta. Tommy Viter, spokesman for the National Security Council, said in an email statement. Kelly is the Florida woman whose complaint to the FBI led to a probe that uncovered an affair between Petraeus, a retired Army general, and his biographer, Paula Broadwell. U.S. officials have said FBI agents last night searched Broadwell's North Carolina home as U.S. lawmakers questioned the handling of the investigation that led to Petraeus' resignation as head of Central Intelligence Agency on November the 9th. So this whole situation with that is becoming very, very sticky. And that's it for the news today. Let's jump right over to the topic of the show today, which is the Hopi prophecy, or the Hopi prophecies. Was there somewhere in particular that you wanted to start, Jeff, or did you want me to just jump in with some reading and we can go from there?
Well, maybe you could tell them. There may be people out there that don't know what the Hopi are, who they are, or what the Hopi prophecy is. Maybe you could give a little background on that.
Right. And the Hopi Indians, from what I understand, were one of the and you may know more about this than me, and forgive me, I lost the page I was looking for.
Would you like me to tell them?
Please go right ahead.
I don't claim to be an expert on this, but I've been following the Hopi for many, many years, and I've visited their reservation. Haven't really been to any of the communities there, but I've been to the land, a place called Black Mesa. The Hopi are they themselves some people liken them to sort of like the Tibetans of North America. They're sort of a little different from a lot of the other Native American tribes. The name itself means the people of peace, because they've always been a peaceful people that never engaged in like warfare or fighting or anything like that. And they were able to live sort of isolated up on these mesas or plateaus in southeast Arizona. And they themselves, last year I read a book called The Book of the Hopi by Frank Waters, and which is still one of the most authoritative books about their worldview and cosmology. But they say that their ancestors migrated up from South America or in Central America, and that there's these different clans, and they're constantly undergoing a permanent migration pattern around the world, and this has been going on for many, many, many thousands of years. And they've always been one of my favorite Native American groups because of their cosmology going back many thousands of years that's been passed down. And we think of it as the Hopi prophecies, and that's what we're going to talk about. But I don't know. I believe that they were never originally written down. And I don't know.
As far as I understand it, it's the pictographs that have been translated over to English language is the only way that we have them. And correct me if I'm wrong here, Jeff, but don't the Hopi claim that they are were actually originally from another star system?
That I don't know about. A lot of Native American groups do say that they originally came from the stars. I know what we commonly think of as the Cherokee, but the Cherokee, that's not what they call themselves. Their actual name for their self is Salagi, Salagi. The Salagi say that their distant ancestors came from the Pleiades and the constellation Taurus. And I think a lot of other indigenous people say that they came from there too, but it's hard to know.
Hopi, I believe it was Sirius.
This is in a different part of the sky.
Oh,
it's in the Canis Major.
Right. Okay.
It's in the winter heavens that you can see from the northern hemisphere. But regardless, it's hard to know exactly what they mean by saying that that's where they're from. But ultimately, it doesn't really matter. I think that the fact that they've just been on this planet for a long time is what we need to look at. But I think that like other indigenous people, most of them didn't have any sort of written language until very recent times, and so all of their worldview and cosmology and knowledge and wisdom was passed down orally. And I think there are diagrams on a place called Prophecy Rock on the Hopi Reservation, and that is a single sort of large pictograph that supposedly describes the Hopi prophecy. And it's never been allowed to be photographed, but people can come and copy it by drawing and stuff. And,
oh, I did not know that.
Yes, unless that's been corrupted in recent years, but up until, the last I heard, they still don't allow anybody to photograph it. But I can actually email you this. I made a large painting or drawing of it on a piece of board about a meter and a half square on Flinders Island last year, and I can email you that if you want to put it up as part of the video for the YouTube. When you do the YouTube video, do you put any graphics or visuals along with it?
Absolutely, sure. I usually insert a picture of a banner of the show and a banner of UCY television, and then okay. pictures depicting whatever the show topic was about. So, absolutely.
I could send you a few images that would go along with this. But the Hopi prophecy, it's probably a pretty vast body of knowledge or wisdom that's been transmitted, but the part that I'm familiar with is the three prophecies that were expressed in this really good movie called Koyaanisqatsi.
Wonderful movie, yes.
Oh, they call it a nonverbal film. This one was made by cinematographer Ron Fricke, who I consider to be the most advanced person doing film work on the planet today. Not that I know that much about the whole film community, but of all the filmmakers I know about, he's light years ahead of everybody else. But his first film was Kronos, which was for IMAX, and then Koyaanisqatsi was actually part of the Qatsi trilogy, originally conceived by a guy named Godfrey Reggio, who's the executive producer. He lives in Santa Fe, New Mexico. And also worked with a guy named Alton Walpole, who I talked to on the phone one time. But these three guys, Godfrey Reggio, Alton Walpole, and Ron Fricke, are the main, and a guy named Mark Magison worked on the film too. But Koyaanisqatsi is a word.
Sorry to interrupt you. I just want to let you know I did just drop a link for that movie on Hulu into chat for anybody who wants to check it out and has access to Hulu. It is there. I'm sorry, Jeff, go right ahead.
Koyaanisqatsi is a Hopi word that means life out of balance or crazy life or a way of living that demands another way of living. And to me, it's very interesting that the Hopis have a single word for this concept that they've had for many, many, many thousands of years. And Qatsi means life or way of life. And so this series of films was originally conceived as what Godfrey Reggio calls the Qatsi trilogy, There was koyaanisqatsi, which means life out of balance or crazy life. There's powakatsi, that means a way of life or a being that derives its energy from other life forms, sort of like a sorcerer that derives its energy from other life forms. So, and like powa, that may be where the word power comes from. But powakatsi is like, it's like our civilization is sort of a vampire or a parasite.
Energy vampires, yeah.
Absolutely.
And then another whole show in itself.
Absolutely. Well, each of these. Nikoyakatsi means time of war. But in terms of these movies, all three of these have been made into movies, but the only one that Ron Fricke made is Koyaanisqatsi. And consequently, it's the only one that's really good. I've seen the other two, and while they on the surface they seem to be all right, and Philip Glass did the soundtrack to all three. Mm. But the Koyaanisqatsi is the one that's got the real power to it. And
I agree with you more. It definitely is the most moving of the three. And I had seen it actually back in the 80s, found it at an offbeat video store, and had watched it then. And even at that point, well before waking up to anything, changed my life and how
yes,
I looked at
I've
things.
Seen it in the theater.
So it would have been probably the earliest that I can recall of beginning to wake up to what was happening in the world around us. And it really, the way he depicted it, the only way I can describe it for people who haven't seen it, it really makes what mankind has done to this planet look like a bad virus.
It's a very
and
powerful.
It really,
it's
very powerful indeed.
He uses a lot of footage that he shot himself. He also used a lot of stock footage of different kinds of military and industrial disasters and nuclear reactors and spacecraft taking off and blowing up and stuff like that. But what Fricke does is he uses Todd A 70mm camera, which is the largest film format that exists. And for each of his films, he builds his own version of the camera so that it can sort of move like a telescope with an equatorial mount, so that the camera can track objects moving across the sky and do incredible time lapse. Like, he has scenes where he compresses several hours into just a couple of minutes. So, and then he has a lot of footage of where like the traffic in the city going really fast, and it stops and starts, and it sounds like it's breathing. It's sort of like a living thing. In his scenes of the Southwest and the but what the movie does is it sort of tells the story of these three main prophecies of the Hopi prophecy, and Philip Glass's soundtrack actually has it's performed by the Philip Glass Ensemble, which is 11 musicians. And interestingly, in Melbourne a couple of months ago, I was actually able to see the Philip Glass Ensemble perform the soundtrack to Koyaanisqatsi live, and showed the movie. They showed the movie behind them, and it was really powerful to watch these musicians sit there and play this really complex music. And they weren't even looking at the film. They were looking at the conductor.
Oh, that is
very
incredible.
Amazing. But there's vocalists that are singing. Ah, and it was really weird. I finally learned that they're actually singing the Hopi prophecy in Hopi.
Oh, wow.
I never knew that. And here's the three prophecies that the movie is about. The movie tells the story without any words, just with pictures and music. Near the day of purification, there will be cobwebs spun back and forth in the sky. Near the day of purification, a gourd or a container of ash will be thrown from the sky that will burn the land and boil the oceans. And the one that I think is the most relevant to what's happening in the world are, if we dig precious things from the land, we will invite disaster. And so with the first one, the cobwebs spun back and forth in the sky, like back in the 80s when the film came out, we all thought that that was referring to the high-tension power lines carrying the electricity, like out across the Hopi Reservation from Shiprock there, from the giant coal-fired power plant.
We know a little bit different now, don't we?
Now we know that it could be describing the barrage of chemtrails that you
chemtrails.
See over every major metropolitan area.
Exactly.
And if we dig precious things from the land, we will invite disaster. That's sort of the story of industrial civilization, because if you look at the danger that and the damage that we've created by all the stuff that we've mined out, and it's almost like that it's just violating one of the most fundamental principles that we were warned against. And before we go into that, I just wanted to add that the Hopis, part of their worldview is that we're living in what they call the fourth world of human beings, and that the previous ones were destroyed by the Great Spirit because the people as a whole had come to live so far off the path of what the Great Spirit had laid down as the way of life that was right for us. The people had deviated so severely that eventually the Great Spirit just wiped everything out. That's what the Day of Purification is. And they say that once it happened by fire, once it happened by water, once it happened by wind. And so apparently a lot of people think that we're seeing all the signs of the Day of Purification being at hand because of the fulfillment of these prophecies. When the Hopi elders saw the atomic bomb go off in 1945, they recognized that as the fulfillment of their gourd of ash prophecy. And they actually went to the United Nations and made a journey there to try to tell people that a really dangerous threshold had been crossed in terms of where we were.
Were they made to wait for I think it was a period of 4 days before they were even allowed to speak in front of the United Nations concerning that?
Probably. I don't know all the details.
That was quite some time before they were even allowed to speak. And you were referring to the four past civilizations. I think the last one was the time of the animals. And I believe what they're saying, the age that we're going into now is the age of the human being, or the age of consciousness, would be the fifth age that you were speaking of, that we're about to enter at this point.
Well, I think that's uncertain.
I do understand that from them as well, that although their prophecies that many have come to pass, that they are not set in stone, that we can make changes and stop any upheaval from happening, but it doesn't unfortunately look like that's going to come to pass.
Well, as I understand it, what the Day of Purification results in is the destruction of everything on the planet. Just about, apparently, all people were destroyed except for a tiny handful of people called the People of One Heart, who are the people that still live in the way of the Great Spirit and live centered in their heart chakra, and they still have the portal open on top of their head from the crown chakra so that they can receive the highest guidance from the Great Spirit and know how to be in the right place at the right time. And most people are totally cut off from that, I think. But the thing is, what we don't know what time period the Day of Purification happens over. Is it overnight? Or is it over a week? Or is it over a year? Or is it over 100 years or 1,000 years? There's no way to know, because but I would say that all the signs are there and see, another thing that they never talked about that's possibly new now. It might conjure up images of Atlantis or something, but the fact that all of our most advanced technologies are weapons of destruction. We've used our most advanced knowledge to create things like atomic bombs and technotronic weapon systems like HARP, giant microwave, ionospheric heaters, and things like genetic engineering and depleted uranium and all this stuff. And so,
that's the stuff we know about.
Well, yes, exactly. But that's unbelievable. The whole nuclear scenario, it's a nightmare, and it's vast, astronomically dangerous, and it all originated from digging one precious thing from the land called uranium. And so it's
right.
Like that part of the warning. That's what we've done when we dig these precious things from the land. So it's possible that the Day of Purification this time could happen by our own hand. It could be happening in slow motion all around us as we speak right now through the accumulation.
Completely makes me think about the Louisiana sinkhole and what is transpiring there with the ground under their feet and what they've done to it by fracking. What a lot of people don't realize is they think that there's a war for oil. The war is not for oil. The war is for the rare earth elements that are revealed by pulling the oil out of the ground. And they're after the oil for petrol, but they're after the rare earth elements that are within those oil deposits that are vastly more important to the powers that be than the actual oil itself is.
I'd like to recommend an excellent documentary film that you people go and watch. If you could type this URL up if you want to, or I'll just tell it to you. There's this brilliant filmmaking company in Munich, Germany called Anthro Media, and they've made a really brilliant documentary called The Struggle for Oil. If you go to their website, it's anthro-media.com. It's lowercase anthro-media.com. And find their film called The Struggle for Oil. It's a brilliant documentary about what's going on in terms of the petroleum thing. But the most interesting part is that they, the last fourth of the film, they go to Russia and interview these scientists that are exploring what's known as the abiogenic hypothesis of the origin of petroleum, which means that we've been led to believe that petroleum originates from decayed plant and animal matter that's down in the ground and subjected to pressure for millions of years. But what they're saying is that there may be oil that originated that way, but the vast majority of it comes from really deep down in the mantle of the Earth, hundreds of kilometers down in there, and it's constantly being created by geochemical processes. And so, in other words, what they're saying is there's a lot more down there than we think. The oil companies know this already. And not only that, it's being constantly regenerated. There's stories of oil reservoirs in the Middle East that were drained dry, and then 10 years later they were full again. So that throws another whole dimension into this. It's like a nightmare scenario, because a lot of people go like, oh, yeah, well, we'll eventually run out. And they go, no, what if we don't?
What if we don't? And what if it's not the oil that they're after? And that's where everybody's being fooled. And, you know, unfortunately, they've turned the ground underneath our feet to toxic Swiss cheese, pulling out these elements that that don't refill, that are created once and that's it. And unfortunately, that's what's happening down in Louisiana. At least that's what I believe, and many others do as well, that's the reason for the all the issues they're having with the sinkhole down there. And I did forget to mention at the beginning of the hour, we do take calls. So if you'd like to call in, the call-in number for the show is 718-717-8296. It's also posted on the homepage for chat, which is UCYTV / Nightwatch. So if anybody has any questions for myself or for Jeff, please call in. And anybody in chat, if you have questions, please drop them in there as well. Hey, Jeff, I'd like to do right now, if you don't mind, is read a quick excerpts from the translated prophecies, and then we can get back in. A lot of it has to do with exactly what you were talking about.
Yes. What is your source for this?
I'll drop you the link from what I'm reading into Skype. There you go, sir. And, of course, it's titled Hopi Prophecy. The end of all Hopi ceremonialism will come when a Kachina removes his mask during a dance in the plaza before uninitiated children, the general public. For a while, there will be no more ceremonies, no more faith. Then, Arabi will be rejuvenated with its faith and ceremonies, marking the start of a new cycle of Hopi life. World War III will be started by those peoples who first revealed the light, the divine wisdom or intelligence, in the other old countries, India, China, Islamic nations, Africa. The United States will be destroyed, land and people, by atomic bombs and radioactivity. Only the Hopis and their homeland will be preserved as an oasis to which refugees will flee. Bomb shelters are a fallacy. It is only materialistic people who seek to make shelters. Those who are at peace in their hearts already are in the great shelter of life. There is no shelter for evil. Those who take no part in making of world division by ideology are ready to resume life in another world, be they black, white, red, or yellow race. They are all one, brothers. The war will be a spiritual conflict with material matters. Material matters will be destroyed by spiritual beings who will remain to create one world and one nation under one power, that of the Creator. That time is not far off. It will come when the Sakwasoha Blue Star Kachina dances in the plaza and removes his mask. I had that word down 10 times before I said it and couldn't say it over again. He represents a blue star, far off and yet invisible, which will make its appearance soon. The time is foretold by a song sung during the Wuwuchim ceremony. It was sung in 1914, just before World War I, and again in 1940, before World War II, describing the disunity, corruption, and hatred contaminating Hopi rituals, which were followed by the same evils spreading over the world. The same song was sung in 1961 during the Wuwuchim ceremony. The emergence of the future fifth world has begun. It is being made by the humble people of little nations, tribes, and racial minorities. Quote, you can read this in the earth itself. Plant forms from previous worlds are beginning to spring up as seeds, as described in SW2 Effects and Coming Events, number one. This could start a new study of botany if people were wise enough to read them. The same kinds of seeds are being planted in the sky as stars. The same kind of seeds are being planted in our hearts. All these are the same, depending on how you look at them. That is what makes the emergence of the next fifth world. Quote, these comprise the nine most important prophecies of the Hopis, connected with the creation of the nine worlds, the three previous worlds on which we lived, the present fourth world, the three future worlds we have yet to experience, and the world of Taiwa, the creator, and his nephew, Sotuknang. The Hopi and others who were saved from the Great Flood made a sacred covenant with the Great Spirit, never to turn away from him. He made a set of sacred stone tablets called Tiponi, into which he breathed his teachings, prophecies, and warnings. Before the Great Spirit hid himself again, he placed before the leaders of the four different racial groups four different colors and sizes of corn. Each was to choose which would be their food in this world. The Hopi waited until last and picked the smallest ear of corn. At this, the Great Spirit said, quote, it is well done. You have obtained the real corn, for all the others are imitations in which are hidden seeds of different plants. You have shown me your intelligence. For this reason, I will place in your hands these sacred stone tablets, Tiponi, symbol of power and authority over all land and life, to guard, protect, and hold in trust for me until I shall return to you in a later day, for I am the first and I am the last, end quote. The great chieftain of the Bao clan led the faithful ones to his new land, but he fell into evil ways. His two sons scolded him for his mistake, and after he died, they assumed the responsibilities of leadership. Each brother was given a set of Tiponi, and both were instructed to carry them to a place to which the Great Spirit directed them. The elder brother of the Shining Light was told to go immediately to the east, toward the rising sun, and upon reaching his destination to start back immediately to look for his younger brother, who remained on Turtle Island, the continental United States of America. His mission was to help his younger brother to bring about the Purification Day, at which time all evildoers would be punished or destroyed, after which real peace, brotherhood, and everlasting life would be established. The elder brother would restore all land to his younger brother, from whom the evil one among the white men had taken it. The elder brother of the Shining Light also would come to look for Tiponi tablets and fulfill the mission given him by the Great Spirit. And as far as I understand, Jeff, there were four sets of the stone tablets for each corner of the world.
I don't know. I thought there was just two.
It was an interview with a Hopi Indian himself, and forgive me, I can't remember his name. I do have it posted somewhere, but I don't have the ability to play a YouTube video. But from
Dan Ivima?
I'm sorry, sir?
What was it? You don't have to call me sir. Was it Dan Ivima? I have not been knighted by the British Queen, and I hope never to be.
Force of habit.
Was it Dan Ivima?
It may be him, yes. Yeah, it was a series of YouTube videos where he spoke basically reciting the prophecies from word of mouth that he received from clan elders. And what he said
it could have been a guy named Thomas Benyakya. He was a vocal elder spokesman who I met him when I was in Flagstaff in 1986. Am I interrupting you?
No, you're fine, please.
I told Christina on our interview the other day on Nuked Radio that one of the freakiest and most powerful synchronicities of my life was when in April of 96, I mean, excuse me, in April of 1986, we a group of us went from California to a place called Big Mountain on the sort of the border of the Hopi and Navajo reservation, and we were there in support of the the indigenous elders who were going to get forcibly relocated so they could strip mine their land called Black Mesa. And this was an area where some of the uranium for the original atomic bombs had been mined out, as I understand it. But we went there. This is where I first learned about the Hopi prophecy and first learned about the whole nuclear scenario. And we were there in support of these people. I had borrowed a Geiger counter from the University of Santa Cruz and was going around taking readings on the rocks. An F-111 fighter plane flew over at about 100 feet high and terrified us all. It was quite intense. And the Navajo elder women were cooking us their bread that they make. And it was quite a special time. It was a very, very powerful place up there. And so anyway, we were out of touch with the media for a week, and we came down to Flagstaff. And after being out of touch for a week, the headline on the newspaper in the largest letters was the Chernobyl meltdown happened while we were up there, learning about if we dig precious things from the land, we will invite disaster.
Oh, and wow.
Ever since then, that made me become an anti-nuclear or a nuclear awareness activist for the whole, you know, until this day.
Definitely a huge synchronicity there. It's an amazing story. Oh, and forgive me, where was that again? You said Big Mountain?
Yes, Big Mountain. It's near the sort of the Hopi-Navajo joint use area, near the border of Arizona and Utah. They call it the Four Corners area.
Right. Yeah, I've definitely always wanted to visit, unfortunately. I was raised in Southern California, but never did make it over that way.
You should go there. There's a place called Monument Valley with all these ancient extinct volcanoes. There are these chimneys, these sort of plateau things rising up. And it's really powerful, but there's a lot of footage from in Coyonascotsi was actually shot there.
I was going to make
a footnote about Ron Fricke. His next film after Coyonascotsi was called Baraka,
which I did watch the other day after getting the hint from you. Thank you very much.
And now he's got his brand new film that just came out this year. It's called Samsara. Not to be confused with another film called Samsara that's about Tibetan monks. But this one is Ron Fricke's Samsara, and it had its debut in London back in August, so it should be appearing in theaters around the world now.
I've not yet heard of it.
Fricke says that his basic philosophy of filmmaking is to explore humanity's relationship with the eternal.
I don't know how much of it there is to explore, save for some certain individuals through the last couple of hundred years who have even bothered to delve into consciousness and what it really means to be human. Unfortunately, people are so caught up in the world that's been made around them that they rarely even look to that. For us, unfortunately, now is coming to light much more.
Can you hear the music that I'm bringing up a little bit?
I can hear it, yes.
It's on the soundtrack to Baraka. Anyway, I had that going in the background. I thought I would just do that for a second.
No, thank you. It was very nice.
I could play some piano at some point, and it would sort of be I could play the Hopi prophecies on piano, but without speaking.
Oh, please do it. While you're doing that, I'll jump over to chat and see if there's any questions that we might be able to jump in and answer.
So I should play some piano right now.
Go right ahead. Absolutely.
I'll do that.
Anybody in chat, Jax, Road, you guys got any questions, shoot them at me. Very, very beautiful piece, Jeff.
Did it come through all right?
Oh, it came through wonderfully. It did on my end, that's for sure. That was beautiful. Thank you very much. I really was grasping. I could almost see the scenery passing me by as you were playing. Very gripping, very emotional piece. We did have a... Oh, I'm sorry?
Go ahead.
Oh, I was just going to say we did have a question from Jackson chat. He had asked about the astroplane maker that shows we're on the outer side. Is it something that you're interested in, and how that relates to where we are in space at this point?
I don't really have any knowledge about that.
Okay. That's something I'll have to answer later. Sorry about that, Jax. I'll dig into it a little bit more.
I do know that a lot of people think that we have to go into space in order to survive or to go explore the universe, but we're already in space. I think it's a very common delusion to think that we're not in space, because if you look at the Earth and where we are, we're in nothing but space. The Earth's a tiny little dot in the middle of a giant piece of space.
Right.
So we don't need to go in space. We're already there.
I could not agree more. And you know, I see us as a very tiny speck comparatively, and think of myself in that way as well, as basically a thought in the ether, and that we're definitely already in space. It's just our imagination of the 3D world that creates what's around us. And therefore, I wholeheartedly believe, as the Hopi did, that it can be changed. And I do see that more and more lately. I had gone quite a few years where I had been losing hope in my fellow man. And it really has come to light over the last couple of years that people are really starting to move towards, more and more people anyway, towards a unifying consciousness and really becoming one with nature again. It's quite amazing to watch. You know, a lot of people are on the forums I'm on are constantly talking about sheeple and how people are, and I'm just as bad too, you know, talking about how people are so asleep to what is going on. But I really do truly see a movement towards a greater good and a greater consciousness, and people on the street are talking to each other more than ever, and I try to get out as much as possible. So
let's hope so. But you know, one of the things that I talked about in some radio interviews I did in New Zealand a few months ago was the sort of incoherency in a lot of the human process, because we're sort of trapped in some contradictions. The way I see it is that whatever we say, like we're talking right now, and there's people who speak English that can understand what we're saying, but there's a lot of variations and limitations in that whole process. That's if you're trying to use language in an honest way. And then if you want to be manipulative or dishonest with language, there's a whole paradigm devoted to that we're all exposed to all the time.
Right.
Human language is only, well, it's really redundant to say human language, because humans are the only ones who use language. Many other life forms have extremely sophisticated systems of communication, but it's not language.
Right, yeah, echolocation.
Absolutely.
I'm sorry to jump over you, Jeff. You know, I was just informed that the bumper for the end of the show is playing now. So it would seem our time is up. We've come to the end of the show already. I figured we would have a lot more to talk about. We'll have to make a second show. I think only got through
this
portion.
Can I say something really quick? I think that the most dangerous thing that we're doing right now is our damage to the Earth. We're waging war on the Earth through things that our civilization takes for granted, draining out this comes under the category of digging precious things from the land, drilling out the petroleum, the gold, the uranium, the coal, all the precious minerals that you're talking about. This is the body of the Earth, and these substances actually have a function as part of the Earth that we don't understand. And when we dig it out, not only are we disrupting the Earth's processes and making her very unhappy, we're bringing down this really bad stuff on ourselves. Look at what we've done with uranium, the whole nuclear scenario. Look at what we've done with
our soul.
every hydrocarbons are extremely toxic to biological life. And what we have to do is everyone needs to, this is what I think, try to go into your heart and feel, access the pain of Mother Earth and access the love in your heart for life, and try to make small but real changes in how you live that reflect a love of the earth. For example, if we stop driving so much, stop using microwave technology so much, stop eating meat that results that comes from killing animals that didn't ask to be killed. A lot of these things are sort of karmic lead weights around the neck of humanity. And I think if we sort of voluntarily simplify our lives, live simply so that others may simply live, which we think is the basic message from the whales and dolphins, that creates a tangible change that'll help us make it through the coming times and lighten our ecological and spiritual and karmic burden on the earth that's really holding us back.
I could not agree more, my friend. This is exactly why I knew right away that we were going to be good friends. I could not agree with you more, and I do see it happening. For some of us, it's not even a choice. It's just happening naturally, and it's a beautiful thing. Thank you very, very much, Jeff, for coming on the show. Much appreciated, my friend, and please come back. My pleasure. You're welcome back anytime. We have definitely have a lot more to cover on the rest of the prophecies.
Can I tell people our website?
Please do.
It's http://dolphinmatrix.com/Jeff, and it's all lowercase except for the J is capital J, so it's dolphinmatrix.com/Jeff with a capital J. That'll take you to our art, two films that we've made, two of the five, including the trailer for our Beyond film about the whales and dolphins, links to our photography blog about the nuclear scenario, Rachel's Carson of today, about the whales and dolphins, and many other different things. But my email's on there too, which is therockist@yahoo.com.
And I do have a bunch of other links that you sent me as well that I will drop in chat for everybody to check out.
Thanks for that.
You're very welcome. Thank you, my friend. Take care, everybody, and have a wonderful night.
You are now entering a world from which you will never return. You may choose to embrace it or fight it, but you cannot change it, nor can you go back. How you choose to feel will determine how you feel. Accept this willingly, and you will be enlightened. Fight it, and you be damned, but it is your choice to make. Your happiness is in your own mind.
Die Wunder dieser Welt werden dir geschenkt.